Now, this is a poem by Tony Lintemans about part of the male domain, the shed, and he calls it the Shed Manifesto. No matter how grand his house, shed with icing, or winning his wife, enemy of sheds usually, whatever his car, career, position, a man's shed is coagulation, unburdened essence of himself. It is also the shed itself. Hard men can weep in sheds, honking and snuffling for half an hour or more before composing a face to meet the world. The shed understands. Hasn't it always been adjunct, backyard dweller, cat-smeared, overcoat-infested, outcast? The shed is home to the humble. What Darrow, drifting under alcoholic stars, wanting a little warmth, has not dreamed of stumbling through that dark aperture? For the best sheds have no doors, to sleep on wheat bags, tarps, snug in the smell of old dust and kerosene drums. The first religion, love of children, engendered sheds. The second, idolatry of speed, ends there in brittle riding tack and horseshoes hanging from nails, gaskets, dead batteries, engines dismembered and scattered, and sometimes, in backcountry, where the faith has good duco, entire cars on blocks, an offering to shed. Shed has known love, but doesn't like to talk about it, but will, if its rusted reticence is pressed, unloose. For sheds experienced in love have doors and further doors, antique aromas, delicate bat flutterings, unidentifiable dews, a stew of memories cooling in the dark, tire-balding interior. Sometimes it is better not to ask. The shed, like the nose, is too obvious for history, but no conquest starts without it. It is an accident that settlement begins with sheds. Breezy first fleeters of terra firma, while timid cities follow, that Christ first breathed in a shed, that Alexander burst unbeatable from good shed-breeding country. Tyrants are those who have forgotten sheds or prefer, like Genghis, to sleep in a tent. May they rot in earth unblessed by sheds, forever rocking their marble regrets. The shed does not forget. When men forget, the shed is subtle reminder. A man needing a 1/8 drill bit can search the shed for hours, looking first in likely places, pockets of mouldy reefer jackets, small cities of silverfish and empty alum boxes, a child's shoe, its owner long a lawyer, waiting to be glued, then impossible spots. Above the beam where washers rot, for instance, the hollow insides of handlebars, until despair, reducing him to hopeless gestures, he looks in the drawer marked drill, etc. It's there. For a wife, generally, has no feeling for the proper placement of tools. Enraged, crazed, a junk diaspora ensues. Boxes of bolts go flying, blunt scythes attempt shed shortening, a tail shaft becomes battering ram, the cat, a witness, cowering. Exhaustion settles with the dust. The search for the 1/8 drill bit begins again. A man will look in the shed and find himself. The shed is freedom, the soul's aquarium, where memory eddies and the day stands still. O ship of cobwebs riding the busy hills, your intimate cargo sleeping steady, bedded in sump oil seeping through dust, how can I praise you enough? How lucky the snake that slides inside whenever it likes to feel your flesh. For the shed has shadows, and the shadows have weight brushing against its skin. The world with its warnings, stay away from shed. The shed eats everything, grows wearisome. What can a complex organ feed on, if not unquenchable life in objects? I tack this list of virtues to its walls, hammering gently so the wood won't crack, and step back happy. Jed approves. Sheets of roof iron move between their nails. A paint tin pops. Rafters take up their tiny slack. Jed is murmuring. The snake, awake and sensing politics, stops to interpret, to squiggle in the dust. Vote one. Jed.